Hey guys, what is up? Tion here, back again with another video, and today we're going to be attempting Emerald Kaizo Nuzlocke. I'm going to make this video series in parts, so one video usually equals around one gym. If you're not sure where Emerald Kaizo is, it is basically Pokemon Emerald put on steroids. It is an extremely difficult game. In Pokemon Emerald Kaizo, there are no EVs you can learn. The encounter rate for almost every single route is decreased, so it makes it harder to grind. On top of that, every single gym leader has 6 Pokemon with really good held items. Every single trainer in this game also has really good movesets. It is not uncommon to get stalled out by Sunkern in this game. Not to mention, even if we do make it to the Elite Four, every single Elite Four member's Pokemon is level 100. There are a ton of changes to this game to make it as difficult as possible, and if you guys are curious, there will be a link in the description saying all the changes. And without further ado guys, let's go ahead and get into episode 1. I end up choosing Mudkip as our starter because with its typing and stats and everything like that, it's just a really good starter to have, and I think it is better than Torchic and Treecko by far. And funnily enough, we actually almost lose here because we get Sand Attack a ton and we end up missing almost every single one of our tackles. This Zigzagoon did have a Berry Juice, so once we did bring it into yellow, it did heal itself back up, but eventually Zigzagoon ends up running anyway and we end up winning the battle just because the game's taking pity on us. And of course, since this is a Nuzlocke, we have to give our Mudkip a nickname, and we go ahead and name it Island because when I livestream this, I would always name my male Mudkips Island. Next, we have to go battle May. May starts off with a level 5 Treecko, and this is the only battle that we really don't have to grind for, as the only difference is Treecko has Quick Attack instead of Pound. Now that May's out of the way, we go and get our Pokeballs, and our Nuzlocke challenge officially begins. Now in this game, Pokeballs only cost 10 Pokedollars, so they're really, really cheap, so we'll go ahead and buy about 30 of those, plus we get a Premier Ball, but as you can take a look, this encounter rate is absolutely awful. It takes literally about 5 minutes, but eventually we do run into our first encounter for Route 101, and it is a Togepi. I was hoping for a Pidgey to help with the Brawly's gym, but I guess Togepi isn't the worst. Togepi has Double Edge and it did hit us a couple times, and I was kind of worried if we didn't catch this thing, it was gonna kill Island, but luckily we do end up catching Togepi. Togepi only have the moves Charm and Double Edge, so it's really not gonna be useful for right now unless we grind it up a ton, and I really don't plan on doing that right now. Of course, we have to give it a nickname, so we go ahead and name it Scrambled because it's an egg and scrambled eggs. Haha, I'm so funny. Now in Old Ale Town, there's actually a couple patches of grass that contain Fire type Pokemon, and we really need some Fire type Pokemon, and I really don't want to get knocked out by them because they're relatively strong, so we go ahead and level up to level 7 just in case. You have a possibility of getting a Charmander in these 2 patches of grass, and that would be ideal here, but we end up not getting Charmander, unfortunately. I end up getting a Numble, but I'm really not too upset about it because Numble actually is not a bad Pokemon. I also forgot to mention, you actually cannot use any items in battle. That is not just an added rule I did in this game. You could literally not use items in battle. I end up using my Premier Ball here, and luckily it catches, and we get ourselves a Numble. Now, it's actually almost necessary to have a fire type for the first part of the game because Petalburg Forest is a pain and there are a ton of bug and grass trainers along the way. We name Numble Yeet because I cannot come up with a better nickname. Our encounter on Route 103 is a Ladybug, which is obviously not a very good Pokemon at all, and I'm pretty sure I will not be using this anytime soon. I do end up catching it though and name it Crutch. The final encounter we get for this area is on Route 102. Now, of course, this encounter rate is awful, but we end up getting a Electrike, which is absolutely amazing. This is awesome for type coverage because there is a few fishermen up ahead that cause me an issue every single run. I mess up here and think that Island's actually part ground, and that's just a stupid mistake on my part, and he does a ton of damage to us, but we switch out into Yeet, and Yeet is part ground, so we are immune. The only move Electrike has at this point is Thunder Shock and Thunder Wave, so it really cannot do anything to Yeet at all. We get Electrike down to a pretty low amount of HP. If we got a critical hit, we would have killed it, but luckily that did not happen, and eventually we do end up catching Electrike. I was very sleep deprived when I was playing this, so I named it No You, because once again, I cannot come up with a better nickname, but I have a feeling No You is going to be crucial to this team. I then grind No You, Island, and Yeet all to level 11, and we also get Togepi a couple levels as well. Now, it's really not necessary to get all the way to level 11 here, but it's better safe than sorry, and also these 2 little patches of grass in Old Ale Town have a higher encounter rate than the rest of the grass around here. Now, we are extremely overleveled for this part of the game, but once again, it's better safe than sorry. This is going to make the first few trainers a breeze. I just end up using Flame Wheel on Youngster Calvin, KOing all of his Pokemon in only one hit. Also, berries in this game is extremely hard to get, and it's really hard to regrow berries, and I'm not even sure if it's possible to regrow berries, so it's really crucial to grab as many as you can. At level 12, Yeet's able to one-shot Sunkern, which is the Sunkern that likes to wall people early on in the game that you hear all about. We were able to one-shot every single Pokemon in our way on this first route, so grinding was definitely worth it. In Petalburg City, there are these 2 patches of grass which contain a water Pokemon, and it is a Krabby. Krabby is definitely not too bad at all. We end up catching this Krabby and naming naming it With Butter due to the run I did with Krabby earlier on, and I also named that Krabby With Butter. On the next route, we run into a level 7 Snubbull, and I'm not really sure what I could use Snubbull for. I really don't have a plan for it at this point. We name it Rar, and it's actually our 7th Pokemon, so it goes into the PC. No U then uses Thundershock on the Spur Trainer, easily taking it out, and next up is the dreaded Fisherman that everybody hates, especially me. But since we got extremely lucky and got Electrike on Route 102, we are able to use Thundershock, taking out all of his Pokemon in only one hit. If Noyu doesn't die, this is going to be one of our strongest Pokemon. I could already feel it. We finally beat the dreaded Fisherman, and then we head into the Petalburg Forest. In the Petalburg Forest, we actually run into Silcoon, and we accidentally run away, running away from Silcoon, which is running away from our only encounter. That was just stupid on my part. While fighting this random trainer, we actually get hit with Mudshot, and then a Water Pulse, which is 4x super effective, and we almost lose Yeet here, but we survive with only 2 HP. Now, in the Petalburg Forest, instead of a team Aqua Grunt, there is a team Magma Grunt, and he has a full team of 5, and it's extremely dangerous to deal with. We are able to one-shot Magnemite, as we do level up to level 15, we learn Magnitude, which can be a really good move. Next out is Koffing at level 8, who goes for Protect for some reason, but he just denies the inevitable as we destroy it with a Flame Wheel. Next out is Houndour, so we switch into Island here, but Houndour goes for Flipping Toxic, poisoning us, and this is extremely dangerous as we really do not have any antidotes at all. We do land a Water Gun doing a good amount of damage, but I really don't want to stay in, and Houndour uses Pursuit, doing so much damage to Island. Luckily, we are able to finish it off with no U, and next out is Duskull, who has Protect, and he has Leftovers. This is just the game's attempt to have like a Toxic Stall team, which is super annoying, but we are luckily able to use Thundershock, doing a lot of damage to Duskull, as he does connect with a Will-O-Wisp, which is kinda useless because we're a special attacking Pokemon. Luckily though, 3 Thundershocks is enough to take out Duskull, and next up is Bagon, and I have no idea what Bagon has in store for us, so I just switch into Yeet, use Flame Wheel just for pure damage. It's resisted because I forgot and I'm dumb, but one more is enough to take it out. You would think I would know my basic Pokemon types by now, but no. Once we defeat this team, Magma Grunt, he runs away, and we are rewarded with a Great Ball like always. Now, we did get poisoned, so we use a potion on Island, and then we run to a Pokemon Center because, yep, this is not good. On our way, we have to use another potion because we got dangerously close to fainting here, but eventually we do make it to a Pokemon Center, healing, getting rid of the poison, and I'm not gonna make that mistake again, so we go into the Pokemart and we buy a ton of antidotes. On our way to Rustboro City, we run into a double battle with a couple of Smeargles, and this is actually kind of scary. I thought we'd be okay since we outspeed, but for some reason, these Smeargles actually outspeed us, which makes no sense whatsoever. Anyway, this is super dangerous because one Smeargle uses Follow Me, as the other sets up a Focus Punch, which is super scary because I'm not really sure how much a Focus Punch could do. We are able to take out one of these Smeargles though with a combination of Bite and Flame Wheel, but the other Smeargle has a free turn to set up, and now he's ready to use Focus Punch. Noyu gets to level 15 here, and I know we are pretty much over leveled, so I'm really not sure how much this is gonna do, but we get hit with Focus Punch and it does literally nothing. I was worried for nothing. Do you see why it's worth grinding, guys? Make sure if you do attempt this yourself, you grind before you get into these kind of situations. As we're on our way to Rustboro City, we get jumped by Red. Now, Red's in this game, which is actually pretty cool, but we have to be careful because he has a lot of Pokemon with a lot of type coverage. Red leads off with a level 9 Eevee who goes for Quick Attack, doing a little bit of damage, but Flame Wheel does a lot more as we're able to finish it off in only 2 Flame Wheels. Next, Red sends out Bulbasaur, and I really have no idea why, as I know he's not going to outspeed me, and Flame Wheel is more than enough to take it out. Next out is Squirtle, so we switch for Noyu, and we get hit with a Fake Out, not doing any damage at all, as we're able to finish it off with only 1 Fake Out. Next out is Charmander, and we actually stay in to take this thing head-on without using Island, so we use Thundershock, it does a lot of damage, he hits us with Ember, it actually burns us, and we end up taking it out. Red's last Pokemon is a level 9 Pikachu, who goes for Seismic Toss, doing an okay amount of damage, but we're able to finish it off with a weak Magnitude 6. I have a feeling Red's gonna be back, and when he is back, it's not gonna be that easy. North of Rustboro, we do run into our next encounter, Grimer at level 9. Now, this does have a move that actually kills itself, so we have to be super careful, and I know this, so we go ahead and use Stomp and hope for a flinch, so he actually doesn't end up killing itself. And that strategy actually worked. Grimer ends up flinching, and we use a Great Ball and catch it first try. I wanted to name this thing Koga, but it's a female, so we name it Koga-et. In a few battles, Island's actually not doing too well, so I go ahead and grind Island all the way up to level 16, where Island evolves into Marsh Tom. Island also wants to learn Mudshot, which is an extremely good move, so we replace Tackle, and now I have a feeling Island will do a lot better. We are now 4x weak to grass, though, and these movesets are absolutely ridiculous in this game, so we do have to be careful. In Rustboro Tunnel, our first encounter is a level 12 Nosepass. Now, I am sleep-deprived, like I said, so I kill Nosepass without even realizing it's my first encounter, and I do not realize until right about now. I feel kind of stupid. I know Nosepass isn't the best, but I definitely could have used them. This is actually a really good place to grind, and before I even think about taking on Roxanne, we need to have some serious levels put on. Before taking on Roxanne, we need to have a good understanding of what her team looks like, and as you can see, she has a really good well-rounded team with really good moves as well. And I do not want to lose this. This is my first attempt. I have not died yet. What you guys have saw has been my very first attempt, and I don't want to take any chances, so before I take on Roxanne, I'm going to grind up all the way up into the high 20s. Eventually, I get Yeet, No You, and Island all the way up to level 23. This is a pretty good start, but I do not think that we are quite ready to take on Roxanne. Also, in Rustboro City, we do have these four patches of grass, which have a high encounter rate, and it also has an encounter we have not got yet. This encounter turns out to be a C-Dot, definitely not the best, as we could have had a Bulbasaur, but C-Dot isn't too bad. I also underestimate No Use power, and it's just silly of me looking back at it. We use Bite on C-Dot, which is pretty stupid. We should have used Shockwave or switched out or something, but we end up killing C-Dot, so that means no Shiftry for us. And just to gauge where we're at, we go ahead and challenge some of the trainers inside of Roxanne's gym, and they definitely are not a pushover. They actually have a really good teams as well. This battle was relatively easy, but the next one was way too close for comfort. This trainer leads off with a Aeron, who goes down with only one Mudshot. Next up is Yanma, who hits us with a Giga Drain, so we have to switch out into Yeet, take it out with a Flame Wheel. Next up is Rhyhorn, who hits us pretty hard, but we end up taking it out. And we also go into Island, and I'm not really sure what this thing's gonna hit us with, so we switch into No You, and we get hit with an Earthquake, almost taking out No You. So we switch back into Island, and this thing is absolutely wrecking us. We are able to one-shot Lovretar with a Water Gun, but next up is Corsola, and Corsola has some potential to do some damage, but the only Pokemon that we have a super effective move against only has 14 HP, so if this doesn't take it out, No You is dead. And oh my gosh, whew, that was really close. We definitely have to grind some more. At level 26, No You evolves into Manectric. This is going to be definitely needed for this Roxanne fight. With this evolution and improved stats, I definitely think we have a shot at Roxanne. I actually want to come into this fight with another Pokemon, so we end up grinding up Kogaet. Now, Kogaet does get kind of low here, but it can definitely hold its own. As we're grinding, we run into a Ralts, and for some reason, this Ralts goes for Confusion instead of Teleport like it always does, and we end up losing Kogaet. With Butter also ends up dying, unfortunately. Unfortunately, which is not good at all, so now we have two deaths. It's now time for Roxanne. I grind up a few more levels on Island just in case. You can never be over prepared for this battle. She leads off with a level 15 Nosepass, who has a Citrus Berry, Self-Destruct, Seismic Toss, Thunder Wave, and Attract. We're luckily able to take it out with one Bubble Beam. Next out is Lileep, who has a Citrus Berry, Sludge Bomb, Giga Drain, Rock Tomb, and Recover, so we have to switch out for Yeet and use Flame Wheel. Flame Wheel does a good amount of damage, but Lileep has that Citrus Berry and heals back to full HP as we hit it with another Flame Wheel, doing a good amount of damage. One more Flame Wheel is enough to take it out. Next out is Relicanth, who has a Citrus Berry, Rock Tomb, Mudshot, Amnesia, and Ice Beam, so we switch out the No You and use Wild Charge. Wild Charge is super effective, and Relicanth easily goes down. Next out is Anorith at level 14, who has a Lumberry, Aerial Ace, Brick Break, Rock Tomb, and X Scissor. We stay in with No You and hit it with the Wild Charge, taking it out in one hit. Next out is Shuckle, who is super defensive and has a Citrus Berry, Toxic, Defense Curl, Rollout, and Sunny Day. We really have to be careful here. Shuckle started setting up a Rollout, doing a little bit of damage every time, so we go for Stomp, hopefully getting the flinch and stopping the rollout, and that's exactly what happened. Yeet goes for Flame Wheel, burning Shuckle, and one more Flame Wheel is enough to take it out. Next out is Lunatone. Lunatone has a Lumberry, Hypnosis, Moonlight, Confusion, and Icy Wind, and unfortunately for us, Shuckle set up a Sunny Day the turn before. One Bubble Beam is not quite enough to take out Lunatone, but one more will seal the deal, and just like that, we defeated Roxanne. Just to get past the first gym, that took 12 in-game hours. That's gonna be the end of this episode, guys. I hope you did enjoy. If you want to see more, make sure to let me know down in the comments below and leave a like. In the next episode, we're going to be attempting to take on Brawly. Like I said, guys, I hope you guys enjoyed, and if you did, smash that like button, and I will see you guys in the next one. Peace out, guys.